like you run around with guys like me till sundown. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Girls like you love fun and yeah, me do what I want. When I come through, I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I need a girl like you, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Girls power.
Girls power.
Girls power.
Yes, we can.
Now, I'm going to come back for a better clap, but for now, you are welcome to the Girls Girls Power Talk Show. My name is Edith Esnam Asimani. I hope you're having a splendid Saturday, especially because, you know, we just celebrated International Women's Day, so I'm still in celebration mood. I'm very excited. We have a bunch of powerful female panelists here, and I want to wish every single woman out there a happy International Women's Day. We appreciate your strength, we appreciate your motivation, we appreciate your mentoring role in shaping people like us in society. So we can only give you a girl's power thing. So girl's power.
Girl's power.
Girl's power.
Yes.
That was to you. Thank you so much. So, because this week, you know, is International Women's Week, in fact, the whole month is International Women's Month, it is important that we look at how women become women. And women become women by becoming adolescents. They were once babies, they became, children, under 18. In fact, they were adolescents, and then they grew up to become the strong women they are. So, if we do not talk about the health of adolescent girls, there's no way we are going to have women to celebrate. And it is the reason why today on the Girls Girls Power Talk Show, brought to you by the Ministry of Gender, Children and Social Protection, UNICEF and UNFPA, we are going to be delving into issues of adolescent girls' health. We'll be looking at nutrition, menstrual hygiene management, personal hygiene, all of those things that I know you'd love to hear on a Saturday morning. So stay tuned. Remember, we are live on Facebook. We love to use technology. So on Facebook, you can watch this live when you search for the Ghana Broadcasting Corporation page, or you can even go on the website www.gbcghanaonline.com and watch us live. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
A girl should not hurt. Being a girl should not be a burden.
Why should girls come second?
Girls need education,
full time,
skills.
When girls do better, we all do better.
Girls power.
Girls power.
Girls power.
Yes, we can.
But I'm sure my voice and my way of saying girls power would have stuck into your mind every Saturday. You'd be expecting to hear it from me, because I myself wake up on Saturdays and I start screaming girls power on my bed. But anyway, a happy Saturday to you, and I am pleased to introduce to you our very strong panelists who are going to be discussing with us adolescent girls' health. To my right, somebody, if you've been watching the show every week, I am sure you would not forget this face. Her name is Tammy Adukobukari, and she is the nutritionist. She's a nutritionist and a health promotion specialist at the Gan West Municipal Health Directorate. You're welcome, Tammy. Just after Tani is a very beautiful young woman, very, very young. her name is Mrs. Gertrude Kwashiga. She's the acting national coordinator of the Ghana School Feeding Program under the Ministry of Gender, Children and Social Protection. You're welcome, Mrs. Kwashiga.
Thank you.
I think you're the youngest in the panel. And then we have Abigail Mamleteria. She's our girl icon for this week. Abigail is a sexual and reproductive health advocate. She's a very powerful young woman in her community. She's making change, and she has a lot of interventions on menstrual health management in her community. She's also a member of the UNICEF U Report team, right, Abigail? Sorry. Abigail, you're welcome, and I'm so happy to have you on the show.
Thank you.
Please, so you want me to beg you to clap for Abigail? Thank you so much. So I'm going to start right with Tani. Tani, I mean, you know what our first question will be, right? Like, what constitutes adolescent nutrition, especially for girls? Because today the focus is on girls and how they can grow up to become women we can celebrate. So what is nutrition, and what kind of nutrition is beneficial to growing girls?
Thank you. I think when it comes to adolescent nutrition, it's so important that we discuss such a topic because we all know adolescence is a transition period into adulthood. I personally call it the make or break period in life, because if you have an unhealthy adolescent who grow into an unhealthy adult, this unhealthy adult will give birth to an unhealthy child, and it becomes a kind of vicious cycle that never ends. So it's a very important topic. For nutrition, as a nutritionist, when you ask what constitutes good nutrition, I look at it not just from what is on the plate of the adolescent, but the whole digestive process, how it goes through. So, for instance, the adolescents, what should you eat to for us to say that it's a well-balanced or an adequate diet you are having, okay? So we need to eat from various foods to be able to get nutrients, being it micronutrients, mm-hmm. macronutrients. The macronutrients are like carbohydrates, mm-hmm. proteins, fats. And then when we come to the micronutrients, we will have, vitamins and minerals, you know. But so you need to make sure that all these foods are on your plate. And when we talk of carbohydrates, most of the times when we eat, it's refined carbohydrates that we think. So for the food to be constitute an adequate diet, we need to eat from complex carbohydrates. That's carbohydrates that are not refined, okay? And usually when we talk of refined carbohydrates, people think, people go straight to think about, let's say, industrialized foods or something. Mm-hmm. But I do say that we refine some of these foods ourselves. For instance, if you're going to prepare, let's say, banku in your kitchen, and then after mixing the dough, you decide to sieve it, to sieve this food and take off the chaff, you've refined it. Okay, so you've kind of minimized the nutritional adequacy of that food. Okay, so adolescents are challenged with, in Ghana here, I think when we are talking of the triple burden of malnutrition in adolescents, not just adolescents, but then you see that some are undernourished in terms of, some are undernourished, it could be micronutrient deficiency, it could be what we call hidden hunger, or just a deficiency in some of the micronutrients, it could be iron, calcium, zinc. And then we have the same population that are also challenged with obesity. Okay, so we need to tackle all these things holistically, so that when an adolescent is eating, you have to have the mind that this food I'm eating is good for me. Mm-hmm. So you make sure you choose foods that are so healthy, okay? Mm-hmm. That are not too refined, that are not too sugary, too fatty. And then at the end of the day, you put all these things together to make a healthy diet for you.
Right. Thank you so much, Tani. Remember that we also have a Facebook page. You can like and even send your comments there, because, you know, we started the discussion. I bet you have questions. I bet you have contributions. You can send your comments there. We'll read it live on the show. You can also send us a text message or a WhatsApp message to the number 050-606-7424, 050-606-7424, and we'll read them live on the show. So, on that note, Mrs. Kwashiga, I know in your line of work, within the school feeding program, how critical is, you know, ensuring adolescent nutrition? Because from what Tani says, it is merely about ensuring a balance, a very strong balanced diet, and also ensuring that we do not refine, you know, the natural food product. So how critical are these things in the feeding program?
Yes, it is very important because, as Abigail has said, you look at the four-star diets. And so that's mainly
four-star diets.
Yes, that's what she has mentioned.
Okay.
As a protein, carbohydrate, green leafy vegetables, you know, and also fruits, you see. And so oil and fats, you know, those are the main areas that constitute good healthy habits. You know, so we want to have a balanced diet, so you should be looking at those areas. And then most of these things are there. But then when you look at the communities where we are, or we go from, most of these things are there. Those are grown there in the various districts and then the various, villages, you know, where, you know, most farmers just grow the farm. And then there are things lying down everywhere. And so we have the foodstuffs there, or the farm produce, but we do not know the areas or the importance of what we should eat.
Yes.
And so we actually allow them to go wasted. So why do we have to be having post-harvest losses when we should know that the things that they grow from the farm are meant for us to eat and grow, and actually even grow out of it? See, so eating habits have become a problem in this country. The choice of food to eat has become a problem. And so most of the young adolescent ages going for the fast foods, you see, ready-made, you know, which are full of oils, you see. So you have quantities that you have to eat at each time. And so that makes it balanced for you. So when you are eating, you should look at what actually constitutes your food intake, you know, on the plate. Actually, it actually helps grow your body. And so you have most of this, most of you growing, you know, stunting and then wasting, you know, in some of the regions.
I hope I don't look good.
I hope I'm not standing there with
you. The food composition is there, but it's actually as to how you eat. So we eat in the right quantity and mostly at the right time.
Right.
So there's a proverb that you are what you eat, mostly. So you have to have what you want to eat every day from morning, you know, till night. Even if I ask the young ladies here, what did they take for breakfast this morning?
Abigail, should we start with you?
So we have a lot of things, and our cocoa drink, for example, contains a lot of antioxidants. And then the various areas where you have to look at what actually makes you grow and become very active, very healthy. Each day you get up to go everywhere or to go to school. And then we have our soya that gives you so much protein, you know, and the soya is grown so well in Ghana this day. We have a lot, you know, being grown in the north and even in Bonga-Hafo region. And even we are even lucky that some of these soyas are being processed. And the message about them is for you to eat them and become very active in school, in class, and then it works on your brain faculty as well to become very clever. You know, there are things that are there, but it's because of lack of knowledge our people perish. So we are all perishing to the, you know, the messages that are not going well, and then we have ourselves not being actually trained to advocacies and all that. So I think that we have to intensify these areas very, very well to bring that best of information to the youth of today.
Thank you so much, and that's why I hear Mrs. Kwashiga. So hopefully by the time you leave, we'll stop perishing.
Yeah.
Abigail, so tell me from a personal experience, growing up, did you ever consciously take nutrition seriously?
That's the word, consciously. Consciously, no.
Mm.
Consciously, no. And I think to a large extent, as a people, we are more, especially adolescents, we are more concerned about the taste of what we eat.
We want check.
We save for sweets, we save for biscuits and all that. The nice things that do taste nice in our mouth, but the outcome of it for how it our bodies would develop from that, we don't really pay attention to it. And even for some of the adults, it's we want to look nice from what we wear and what we put on us, more than thinking of how what we eat can also impact how we look. So especially for me, it's just recently that I've come to take time and be conscious of what I eat, the amount of water I drink for a day, and then what I think I would get from each meal I take. So consciously, personally, no. And then to a large extent, so as I said, for a lot of adolescents, we are more concerned about what first will fill our stomach and then what will taste nice in our mouth.
And I, to add to that, I've always said to my clients that people grow to eat the way their parents told them to eat. Okay, because the immediate family environment is very critical in shaping the food habits of adolescents. And I mean, all of us here, my mom, the way she eats and cooks is the way she taught me, and is the way I'll teach my children. So if at a point, if you don't become that conscious of healthy living and then choosing healthy to introduce to the children, they'll grow to eat unhealthy. So the role of parents is very important in making sure that the child you are bringing up eats healthily, so that by the time he or she becomes an adolescent, she will be conscious of the food choices she makes. I know peer has some influence in it, but then food choices, but then if the family environment is so strong about healthy choices and then food habits, I think it will in a way help the adolescent to stay healthy.
That's definitely a strong point. And I don't know if I should go ahead and ask what do you have children, Bunny? what are some of the things you actually do to ensure that they are consciously aware? They don't grow up like myself and Abigail, who are not conscious about their nutrition. Is it that you speak to them like Mrs. Kwashuga, you know, just spoke to us about when you wake up, cocoa is very good for blah blah blah, soya bean is good for making you clear. Is that what you do to your children?
Well, you know, because I'm a nutritionist by profession, and you know, knowledge is very key in making some of these decisions. It's a way I've lived for some time now. So when I go to the market to pick things, even to the house, I make sure that I pick healthy products, being the snack they send to school, the food they eat at home. So my children are still young. I think the girl is just about 8 years. So, but then I make sure what I give her to school for snack, she eats breakfast at home, and then all those things. So it's they will grow up in the world with it. If they see something in school and they want and they come to describe it to me, or we happen to go out to a supermarket and they see something, I have a way of telling them, oh, okay, you know, this thing is good, but you can't have it due to this and that. We try to explain it to them. I know it's challenging, especially at that tender age, to include vegetables. I've had challenges in the initial stage.
I remember I told my mom she's feeding me with leaves and
initial stages, but now they've grown to like vegetables, you know. You have to find a way of adding it, even if it is blending it and mixing it with their meals in the early stages, and then get to a time where you shred it, and but now they enjoy vegetables. So the family environment, the immediate home, is very critical. So first, make sure you pick healthy from the market to the house, and then as time goes on, you talk to them to know the importance of what they are eating to their health.
And the truth is that, you know, growing up as an adolescent, I remember that I really liked things that looked nice. So wouldn't it be great if, you know, you teach us how to do the carrot such that it looks so nice, and then you can't
yes.
prevent yourself from yes, eating it.
Right.
And those are some of the things that I wish that, because the way some of the vegetables look, the way you look at it, you know.
When you look at the way vegetables are, mm-hmm. when they look, that is how the body must look.
Really?
So when you eat it more often, you're going to grow and glow. You know, you look very, very pretty, even from outside.
Now I know your secret.
You must eat a lot of vegetables, especially fruits.
Wow.
We have our bananas there. Do you eat banana? You must eat banana every day. The nutrient formation, you know, nutritional values that some of these foods constitute, you know. So this is why I'm promoting the four-star diet. And also, we must also learn to cook. You see, you don't have to run away from the kitchen. Always be in touch with your parents, you understand? And learn to read on some of these educational areas surrounding food. You are lucky you have technology at the highest level these days. So you can go on the net and download those, you know, areas, but not other things. But you go about doing other things or looking for other things that will not benefit you at this tender age. So I would just like to encourage you, the youth, you know, adolescent that you are, looking pretty, I can see. But then you still have a lot to do. Try and go to the kitchen and learn some of these etiquettes, you know, of food preparations, you know, simple ones that you can blend. You can also, you know, saute some of these vegetables to eat. Learn it, and then learn how to cook. You see, and stop going to the roadside to buy food, because you must know that as you do that every time, you're actually learning to be lazy, and you don't have to consider the hygienic aspect of some of these areas as you inculcate it into your habit, and it's bad. Lifestyle must be given that chance to be more educative, you see, so you learn it and it benefits you, and the society benefits. I think it will give us a lot of benefits at the end of it all.
So, it's just for adolescent girls, because your boys have a way of saying that if it is about the kitchen, then it is about girls. If you need to nourish yourself, it shouldn't be someone else's responsibility. The truth is that we both share responsibility in nourishing ourselves. So please note that Mrs. Kwashiga's advice is not for girls. I needed to put a disclaimer.
So it's gender.
Exactly.
The next one, let's not think that healthy foods are not tasty foods.
Mm.
Okay. Healthy foods can be very tastier than even unhealthy foods.
Mm.
Sandra was asking, how can we make it attractive for you to eat? If you look at vegetables in general, they come in so many colors and so many shapes. Okay. And the general rule is to have a colorful plate. And each food item on your plate has its function. If you have a carrot, it has what it does. You know, it has vitamin A or carotenoid, which is good for what? Your eyesight. If you have a contumere or any green leafy vegetable on it, you know it's rich in iron, which is very essential for adolescent girls because of menstrual instead. You know, so every nutrient or every food that you have on your plate should have a function to play. So you can make your plate colorful and very attractive.
Abigail, I hope you noted that.
To add to that as well, you know, as Abigail has said, you know, we also have the green leafy,
mm-hmm.
especially sweet potatoes leaves, which we don't regard at all.
Mm.
And that is something I'm also promoting. The sweet potato leaves is so rich in vitamin A, you know, as well as iron, and lots of iron booster, and it's good for the adolescents. And so we only know about the cocoyam leaves, that's the kotumri, but we should also, you know, accept the fact that sweet potato leaves is also one area of leaves that will also give us the nutritional balance, you know, that we're looking for, the body is looking for. You know what vitamin A does? You see, so that deficiency is mostly eating into the society of today, and then we have to actually correct it. So I'm preaching that so seriously, and then every, now people call me sweet potato leaves, you know, and then a soya madam or soya mama, you know, that kind of thing. I like it because we have to conscientize the youth of today. We need to sensitize them and send a message to them to know that we need to be very innovative, mm-hmm. and then very, very innovative, very proactive when it comes to things like this. You need to have the idea, knowing very well that nutrition, to me, is about the arts and the science, you know, food composition. So as you consume the idea of putting it in that artistic way, where it looks and cutting it, so that you don't destroy the vital vitamins of some of the vegetables that we have, like the green leafy and others, you must also know that the nutritional balance, the, you know, also constitute the formation of food nutrition in our bodies. So we need to be very, very careful that the nutritional abilities that formulate, you know, our body's growth, it's all in the area of the farm. You see, so we have to really introduce the farmers to accept us as we use their produce to do a lot of things. You understand? So, you know, this topic is very, very broad, as you can see it. But I think I will just leave it for now.
Well, we probably should also be promoting people making their own farms. I know that it's going to be difficult, especially in places like
So this is why now the world is promoting the school gardens for most of the schools, the backyard or school gardens, for example. I think most of the schools are actually trying to come up with the idea. And I saw that last year in the U.S. where the school children are really engaged, especially in their holiday times. They are really engaged into farming, you know, and in the various areas, crops, animal husbandry, and then aquaculture. And you see them in their wilting boots with their t-shirts, and they are preaching a message. And then that falls under agricultural science, you know. So students from, you know, and some of them do not even like to learn, but that is an area that they have adopted. And you see them very happy and happily doing that. I was so enthused, and I was telling myself, I want to carry it to the secretariat so that we can have a portion of our, you know, secretariat being transformed into this kind of, you know, knowledge that has to bring, you know, the youth to know that, you know, the only way that they can grow very well is when the farmers are giving us food from their farm to eat.
Yeah.
We have to appreciate the farmer, and then we have to appreciate also the plenty for food that the president brought. You see, it's not just a mere, you know, word, but the value addition chain falls there. So that's when we have the agricultural business, you know,
and so much. We truly see the need for agriculture.
I think
thank you so much. And you could sense the passion with which she's speaking. It means that she understands, you know, the need for it, and understands the need to preach it.
Yes.
But Abigail, on that note, we are going straight to personal hygiene. I want to talk about adolescent girls' health. We cannot talk nutrition and not, you know, talk about personal hygiene. What are some of the things that you personally did to maintain good hygiene for yourself up until now?
So it had to do with stuff like cutting my nails. For the buffing twice a day, I tried. Twice a day, I tried, but now I'm doing well. Shaving of the armpits and wherever the pubic hair on the vagina and wherever it is, yes, we have to be very clean about these things. You are not shy anymore.
Exactly.
Yes. So it has to do with those things. Washing clothes. My clothes as often as possible so that they do not become very dirty with scents that would not go well for my body. So personally, those are some of the things that I did.
And we know that one of the critical areas of personal hygiene is also menstrual hygiene management.
Exactly.
For the girls that you usually work with, what are some of the major challenges they've opened up to you with regards to menstrual hygiene management?
So a major challenge we've realized, some colleagues and I are organizing some forums on reproductive health, which a critical part has to do with menstruation or menstrual hygiene management. And a major challenge has to do with knowledge. We live in our bodies, but we understand or know very little about these bodies, and a critical part is about menstruation, where we do not even really understand what is happening to us. Even the amount of blood that comes out of us, the pain we experience. Some of us take tablets every month. The effects of that, we do not even know. It was just recently I went to a pharmacy, wanted to buy a drug, and the pharmacist was telling me it could harm my liver, so I should be careful of that. And sometimes it had to do with how often you should even change your pads. Some of these information are not there. And also had to do with the availability of these materials. Sometimes these girls know that they have to do this or that, but
they do not have,
to
buy pads
or the materials or the and also a big challenge also had to do with especially for adolescents who are in school, facilities, toilet facilities that will enable them to be able to change themselves as often, to make sure they are okay during that time, is also sometimes a challenge. Some of the schools don't have it at all. Some of them, where they are positioned, is not good enough, or they are not in good conditions. So some of these are some of the challenges that have come up in our advocacy and engagement with the young girls.
Right. So in the rest of our discussions, we'll be talking about solutions and things we have to do, because those are the key things we need to leave this place with. And just so you know, we had a very intensive discussion about periods and cramps and those kind of things, the drugs you mentioned and all that, last week. And it's available on our Facebook page. So if you would want to go back and watch, that would be awesome. We are going for a short break because we really need to hear what others have to say. But remember still that we are streaming live. I was going to say live streaming. We are streaming live on Facebook on Ghana Broadcasting Corporation, or you could still, you know, catch us live on www.gbcghanaonline.com. Please remember to send in your WhatsApp or text contributions, 050-606-7424. I'll be announcing the phone lines when we come back. Stay tuned.
I believe so. Children are actually the future. In order for us to have, good people or good future leaders, I think we need to check what they eat right from the adolescent stage. And in order to do this, I think you should check how many times you give a child a food. It should be 3 times in a day. What they eat, it should be very nutritious. You should be taking vegetables, fruits, and all those things that will help you grow well.
Yeah, I think good nutrition is very good for the body as you are growing up as an adolescent. You need to eat good so that your body will build up very nicely as you grow up. You know, it will attract what you need to, you know, get as you are growing up.
Every child is supposed to eat the 6 balance diet, which includes vitamins, minerals, calcium, carbohydrates, and proteins. That means that if you're eating, that means you're checking, whether the food is balanced. And what I mean by balanced is you need to make sure if you are eating your banku, you have your okra stew. Okra, of course, is vegetable. So you have your fish, you have your eggs, or let's say chicken or meat, which is very important in the development of the child.
They should take balanced diets, eat a lot of protein, eat a lot of carbohydrates to replenish their energy, eat a lot of foods that give them vitamins, fats and oils, so that they can be able to build up and gain healthy weight. And I say healthy weight, not overweight. So they should watch their weight and not go out of proportion. And it should be something that should be moderate.
Well, I think a lot of children
have this, are being affected, especially from the house, how they are being trained. When you shout on a child like this, it has the psychological effect on them, and even emotional, how you even bring them up, how you strip them. Sometimes you even go overboard. You don't beat a child harshly, or you don't go too harsh on the child. It has an effect on them.
Some of the factors that affect the emotional well-being is thinking too much about boyfriend and girlfriend at this stage. I mean, it's not, you're so young, you know, you're young, you have a long way ahead of you, and the only thing you can do for yourself and your parents is to steady.
The emotional well-being of an adolescent child really is affected by a lot of issues, from their relationship with their parents, their relationship with their mates, their relationship with people at church, on the trusty, in public transport, every single place. Maybe even how they relate with themselves, because you might find that someone has been abused from childhood, and so they have low self-esteem and do not regard themselves that highly.
Get to this adolescent stage, there are a lot of things that comes as you grow up, like body odor and all that, but you need to check it, especially the guys. When you are growing up, you know there is this body odor, so you should, if you don't have deodorants that you use, you should be using lime and all that, all those medicated soaps and all that will help prevent this body odors. You should also be washing your clothes, especially your boxers, else it will give you the scent and all that.
You need to be, you know, make sure that you take good care of your, you know, body, in terms of maybe bath and, you know, putting a roll on. Make sure you are neat, that's it.
The adolescent should maintain good hygiene by, one, when you wake up in the morning, you make sure you brush your teeth, and you make sure you drink enough water in the morning. That's one of the things that we escape. For hygiene, after you brush your teeth, you make sure you take your bath at least twice in a day.
For both boys and girls, it's important that they take their bath at least twice a day, brush their teeth at least twice a day, you know, wash their clothes frequently, keep their environment's needs, lay their beds, sweep their rooms, just basically keep themselves really neat, because it's important they do that, so that it doesn't create... People are averse to body odor and mouth odor and all that, and so adolescents should be able to keep themselves, their private parts, shaved regularly, and be able to keep themselves quite neat.
I believe it is important, because you should exercise. Doing sports and activities help you exercise. If not, that you are you want to train to become a future footballer or something. But I believe that if once you do them, you exercise the body, and then it helps you grow well too.
You need to exercise a lot. You know, exercise is good for the body. As you are growing up, if you exercise, you know, it will give you a nice shape. It will give you, you know, what you need to have as, you know, you're growing up.
We need to exercise, and that is how can we have PE on the calendar for the kids to, you know, participate in these activities. Some of them go like, I'm not interested in sports and all of that, but it's very important. It helps you yourself, because it helps to, you know, keep you fit. Apart from that, it helps burn calories.
Can't overstate how important it is, because it helps to maintain a healthy weight. You can't overdo something or underdo something. You need to keep it in moderation. You need to be able to exercise frequently and in moderation in order to keep a healthy body, healthy mind.
Girls power.
Girls strong.
Girls power.
Yes, we can.
So we've heard a lot. I could hear the thing about washing the boys' boxes and things like that. And I really appreciated the comments on exercising, because when we talk about adolescent health, there's a need to talk about exercising. We wake up and then we go to school and come back and sleep. Hey,
Really, do we want to kill ourselves? So we need to exercise as much as possible. And I know that even within the sphere of exercising, there are some exercises that may be good for you. There may be some that may be too rigorous. So learn, open up, study, go to Google, you know, read from the very, very credible websites where you can get very good information on things like this. So on that note, I wish that we could know more. And if I wanted to know more, Tani, where do I go to? Are there counseling centers around that an adolescent girl or even an adolescent boy could walk to and ask about some of these things?
Okay. I think the last time I came here, I mentioned that Ghana Health Service has a major of its health facilities. At least every district health facility should have an adolescent corner. Mm-hmm. In these adolescent corners, we have focal persons. The focal persons serve as counselors, okay, in the health facilities. They may not be, they aren't experts in all the fields, but at least they are the focal persons that once an adolescent contacts them or brings them, and there's a need for a specific counsel. For instance, if you need counseling for nutrition, she will link with the nutritionist and then you will be provided such a counseling. Aside that, in the schools too, we have our nurses that come around. It's a partnership between the Ghana Education Service and then the Ghana Health Service. We do school health programs. We have some of the schools, especially if it's a boarding school. Mm-hmm. We have nurses stationed there who provide some of this counseling for adolescents.
Right.
And aside that, there is this YMK app. Mm. You must know app that when you go to Play Store, you will get it. There's also another one, I think the Ghana Health Service Family Health Map also, FHP app. Both of the apps, when you go to Play Store, you will be able to chat with a focal person, an adolescent focal person, and then you'll be able to, seek some of the services online. These are trained personnel that you can chat with them. Some of the services that you need, you don't need to. If it's just counseling, for instance, you may not need to go to the health facility if you think you don't want to go at that moment. Right. But with the apps, you get all the information that you need. So I think the app is very handy for those of us who have Android phones. We can access them and then we can make very good use of them. If you don't have, I will entreat all adolescents to walk to the nearest facility and empower if they have adolescent health corner. Mm-hmm. They are there to service. You don't always have to go there just to seek services. We have indoor games because we are trying to build rapport.
So you can go and play or
yes,
and things like that.
And nice. Build confidence of adolescents in seeking health services.
Great.
So they have indoor games. So as you go there with time, you see that you become so friendly with them, you are able to ask them all the questions you need to ask them without feeling shy or things of that sort.
Right. We've done a lot of talk about nutrition. Some talk about menstrual hygiene management. Some talk about personal hygiene and even sports, exercising. Now, emotional well-being of adolescents is extremely important, right? How can we as young people, how can adults and how can even adolescents themselves help to promote emotional well-being of adolescent girls?
So it has a lot to do with creating opportunities for young people to open up,
right,
about things that they are not okay with. But unfortunately, our parents are now very, very busy people. Mm-hmm. In our schools, some in Accra here do have the counseling
all the schools should have. All the schools should have. All they have. Yeah.
But on the ground, not all of them do.
Yeah.
And even functioning, as you said, is another issue. So mental health has a lot to do with being able to share stuff with people, stuff that worry you. And so we have to do a lot about
creating that opportunity for adolescents to be able to open up, and then parents being there maybe the weekend or in the evening when you come back home, be able to establish a little conversation to chat with your kids to find out how they are doing, what they, how their day went, and all those things, will be able to solicit some information that probably personally they wouldn't be willing to walk up to you to share with you.
Right.
But you also starting those things would help a lot.
So going up, what were some of the factors that affected your emotional well-being? I know I'm being very, I'm being like they say, but you know, some of these practical experiences are useful to let people know that they're not the only ones going through something, and it's only okay for them to open up. So Abigail, over to you.
My dad was someone who was really concerned about our performance in school. So for me, it was a big thing for me, academic performance. So whenever, whenever the term ends and my results come and I feel they are not too good for him to be happy about, it's something that worried me or was a major concern for me. And then as adolescents too, it's that stage that relationship feelings towards the other person comes into a major play, and it's a very critical thing that affects the emotional well-being of young people. So it has a lot to do with academic performance, it has to do with relationship as adolescents. That's when we start exploring, and sometimes we get into a whole lot of mess. And then sometimes it has to do with acceptance, even by our female friends.
Right.
How well we think we look, or how well we think we best we are going to fit into the kind of friendship and groups they have, also have a lot to do with our emotional well-being. Yeah.
Well, that's true, because I had a chance to speak to some young people between 10 to 13, and we were discussing the issue about stress. And I initially didn't think that they would have too much to say when we talk about stress, but I was shocked to hear a lot of things. They were literally stressed about the pressure from their parents. They were stressed about, for some people, their parents get divorced, and you know, they are not sure what is happening in the home. They always see their mom cry or their dad doing something. So there's a lot to talk about in terms of emotional well-being, and I hope that you have started. I've seen a few questions. We are going to be addressing those questions the moment we come back from this very short break. Remember that the show is the Girlz Girlz Power Talk Show. Girlz Girlz.
Girlz Show.
Girlz Power.
Yes, we can.
Thank you. We'll be right back.
Girls should not hurt. Being a girl should not be a burden.
Why should girls come second?
Girls need education, full time, skills.
When girls do better, we all do better.
You're welcome back. The program is the Girlz Girlz Power Talk Show, and I've enjoyed the conversation up until now. It's time to open the phone lines, but before that, I'm going to pick some two questions. Remember, we are discussing adolescent girls' health. Very, very important. And if you haven't thought about some of the things, you know, the nutrition, the menstrual hygiene, the sports, the, you know, all of those things, make sure that you start actively and consciously doing them now. And Tani had specifically mentioned, together with Mrs. Auntie Gertrude and Abigail, how important it is for every single person to play a role. So it's not just us adolescents, but the parents also play a critical role. So on that note, Matilda, I think you have a question. Please tell us your full name so that we don't mistake you for another Matilda, and then you ask the question.
Okay. I'm Matilda Japon, and my question is, as we are here now, we are privileged to be having this discussion with you.
Matilda, can you switch, just put on your microphone? Right. No, speak. Just go ahead.
We are privileged to be having the discussion with you and then others who are watching. But then for the average person, especially those in the rural areas, we are talking about nutrition now. So, like, the person who wants to, like, have food on their table and then they can cook yam and then eat. What about those people? How can they have access to this information we are getting right now?
Okay, so that's a good question. But I think GPV goes everywhere. However, I get your point. Tammy had mentioned that they can go to any adolescent health facility. There are adolescent-friendly health facilities in different regions and in different communities. They're actually at district level and at community level. So every adolescent can go to these corners and access information on how to get.
I think with Ghana Health Service, we are everywhere. We have the chief's compounds. Our nurses are everywhere.
Right.
The community health nurses, they've been empowered. We do home visits to teach some of this, to teach this cooking methods and food to create food choices. They do school health programs. No matter where you find yourself, our nurses are there too.
Thank you so much, Tani. So our next question is from the lady in red. Your name?
I'm Mary Kwan. Please, you made mention of cocoyam leaves. Please, I want to know if we can do it like how we usually do our cotomre stew.
Are you saying a sweet potato leaves?
Yes,
okay.
Sweet potato leaves.
Okay.
So please, can we do it like how we do our normal cotomre stew, or we should cut it like vegetables?
And I'm getting very briefly, because we have a lot of people on the line waiting to call, so that we get on to them. Thank
right.
you.
I think that just do it like that of the cotomre stew. You know, green leaves can be handled like that. It's not only sweet potato, but cassava leaves as well, you know. So we have to really inculcate it into our cooking habits, you know. So in part of our menus, we put that one as one of the, you know, the dishes that will make the magic, you know, the booster of iron and other vitamin elements, you see. So we eat it well in the right quantities. We throw these leaves away. Why do we throw them away? We don't know. Like I've said, lack of knowledge. So let's inculcate it now and let's use it in this at our best ability.
Exactly. Yes. Thank you so much, Mrs. Kwashegar. So our phone lines, please start calling. Start dialing 0302-770111. 0302-770111. We'd love to hear your voice. We'd love to hear your contributions. And Deborah has just sent us a WhatsApp message. She says, I'm in love with this program. We are in love with you too, Deborah. Thank you. And I want to be part of the program. How can I be part of it? Just we'll send you information on how you can be part of the program on the WhatsApp line. So do not worry about it at all. And then we have Johnson. Johnson says that he's from Amasaman, Ashaiman. If we talk about adolescent girls, it's not only about their health in terms of the food they eat or the way they eat, but we're also talking about the way they dress and talk. And they, please, this one, they are lying. So Johnson, the issue about dressing and the way we talk and all that is not necessarily an adolescent girl issue. I think that generally responsible way of acting and speaking and dressing, sometimes we make it seem like the girls are the only people. Please, all of us have a responsibility. So Grace Formula is on the line. Hello, Grace.
Hello.
Grace, can you speak up just a bit? You're welcome to the show.
I want to ask that.
Mm-hmm.
Please, I want to ask that if someone's parents are dead and they are living with someone,
mm-hmm.
is it also a cause of emotional problems to them?
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Grace. Abigail, can you take that up for us? Grace, you had a question.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, so usually in our society, it plays a key role. And it depends on the kind of step parents that you have. Some, if you are fortunate enough to have people who are able to take care of you as your parents would have, mm-hmm. then
it wouldn't be too much of a problem. But if it becomes the usual wickedness and unfriendly behavior, then definitely it's going to be a major cause of. So it's not in all situations. It depends on the kind of people that you get to, you are put into the care of, to take care of you. Yeah.
Right. Thank you so much for addressing that. I'd like to ask, you know, link the whole health bit to education. If anyone has a question, do let me know. Oh, Josbeck. So maybe I'll let Josbeck ask her question first, and then we...
Please, Josbeck. Mommy Yolen, a nutritionist, has talked about their field. Mm-hmm. But Mommy has not talked about her field. I want to ask this question. It's not even a question, it's a complaint. Sometimes you'll be walking at the roadside and you hear children saying that today the food that they gave to us at school was very bad. They gave us banku and pepper without fish. Sometimes the rice, the stew too, so watery, and the complaint is so much. And I'm asking, what are you doing about it?
Yes, you are right. I know. I know that you asked me that question. It has become, the complaint of the time, you understand. We came to inherit those problems, and we are trying to see how we can polish them up. I know, as a food production expert, an analyst, a nutritionist, I have identified that the only way that those things can actually be minimized is to take the women to training programs. I call it nutrition and innovative training, which I started last year. And it is true that we can bring these women together and give them a knowledge at the basic level. You know, we don't have to expect that they are like us. So the women will have to do what? Have to be taken through training programs to get to get the information on the field. You understand? Right. So we can do all the magic, but if we don't group them together in zones regarding the various areas that they occupy, we can never get it right. It could be anybody. You understand? So that is one area that WFP is helping us to actually finance through capacity training.
Right.
So we can get these women being trained very well. And then we started it. So we are yet to do what? To continue this year. And it's going to be one of the magics, that we are going to implement. It is true and I mentioned soya. Mm-hmm. When I was talking, I mentioned soya. And this soya is also one of the protein areas that we're going to actually introduce into the eating habits or the cooking habits of food that is prepared for our children. And you see, sometimes the only thing that you people know is fish, chicken, yes. But the money that we give the women, you can see it, that it is nothing too much. One city minus tax. You know, your parents cannot use one city to cook for a home, you understand? So this is why we had to be very, very getting out of the box and very, very, innovative, you understand? And put all this cost benefit into practice, and consider that we can only put some of this farm produce together to make food for our children.
Thank you so much, Mr. Professor. We have just 4 minutes, so I really have to cut you. We received a message from Constancia, who is from Equatorial Guinea. It's good to know that you're watching us live on Facebook. Thank you. She wants to know, if you don't live with a mother figure and you're the only female in a family, how can this emotionally affect you, and what can you do to overcome it? Abia, would you want to take that? Imagine yourself in a situation where you don't have a mother figure.
It's unfortunate that nowadays in our Ghanaian society, our extended family system is breaking down. But that should have been a very good kind of support. But there are still people around who you could look out for to be able to talk to.
Oh, so we've just received a call from Hakim from ACC, so I have to catch you there. Oh, Hakim, we just lost him. Oh, I'm so sorry, Hakim. So we'll just pick a very, very last submission. We'll get out of here. Tell us your name and then your question.
My name is Angela. I want to ask some of the effects of not eating balanced diet.
Okay, Angela, can you just take your response.
Nutrition is very central to our health, okay? If you have a very poor diet,
it means you are going to lack some of the nutrients that should make you very healthy. So you are likely to be sick, you are likely not to concentrate well when you are in school, because if you, especially if your diet is deficient in iron, okay, it makes you not alert when you are in class, you feel dizzy, you already feel tired, you don't even have to do any work, but you're already tired by the time you are in school and you can't concentrate. So you'll be unhealthy, you will not perform well in school as well.
Okay. Thank you so much, Tani. I hope that you have enjoyed the show so far. At least there was one key thing I picked from Mrs. Kwashiga, and it is about the four-star diet. And I hope that you remember to take your protein, your carbohydrates, green leafy vegetables and fruits, right?
Yes.
I got it.
Yes.
So I'm noticing that, you know, calls keep cutting. We are really sorry. We really want to, you know, hear from you. We really want to pick a lot of calls. But you know how technology works, you know. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it is good, sometimes it's bad. We take it like that. But we hope that you can still engage with us on our WhatsApp platforms, on our Facebook platform. I can still share the WhatsApp number with you so that it is easy for you to engage with us. The number is 050-606-7424 050-606-7424, or you can just, you know, type in Girlz Girlz Power Talk Show and on Facebook, and then we will read, you know, your comments. Remember that we've been live, and you know, when we are live, it means that you can always go back to watch it. That's the nice thing about going live. So you can find a video on Facebook at the Ghana Broadcasting Corporation Facebook page, or our own Girlz Girlz, you know, the TikTok show Facebook page. I'm already missing you. I don't want to sign off, but I have to, else Franca and everyone else will beat me up here. So on that note, we have a very last appeal from you. Our last episode will be shown on the 6th of April. I want you to truly note this down, and we want feedback on what topic you want us to revisit, what guests you want us to bring back, what comments or questions, you know, you really enjoyed, and we'll be bringing it back to you on 6th April. So send those comments, you know, those things to our WhatsApp platform 050-606-7424, and we'll work towards, you know, getting you what you want, because we need to package for you. I hope you enjoyed the show. My name is, has always been, I'm sure forever will be, even Esnam Asemeni. I thank you so much, panelists. I need to go through their names again. If you missed out on the show, I'm really sorry, but you can go and meet Abigail Mamleteria, and wherever she is, she's a sexual reproductive health advocate, and she's a member of the UNICEF U Report team. Mrs. Gertrude Kwashiga is the acting national coordinator of the Ghana School Feeding Program under the Ministry of Gender, Children and Social Protection. And finally, Tani Aduko Bukari, chief expert on nutrition. She's a nutritionist and a health promotion specialist at the Ghana West Municipal Health Directorate. I hope you enjoyed the program. I did too. Please keep engaging with us and enjoy the rest of your weekend. Bye. Please, bye bye, everybody. Bye.
Girls Power.
Girls
Power.
Yes, we can.
Nice.
Through 24 hours, I need more hours with you. We spent the weekend getting even more. We spent the late nights making